Hi, I'm Jeff Klein, editor of RadioGraphics, and today I'm pleased to have with us Dr. Scooter Plowman from the Stanford University Medical Center, Clinical Excellence Research Center, and Dr. Constantine Raptis of the Mallinckrodt Institute of Radiology, who are co-authors of one of our featured papers in the current July 2017 issue of RadioGraphics, entitled Imaging of Pregnancy-Related Vascular Complications. Doctors, welcome.
Thank you very much. Nice to be here.
Scooter, let's begin with you. Your paper in the current issue is really a very interesting one. And while we've published a number of papers related to a variety of pregnancy-related imaging issues over the last number of years, we haven't published much on the topic of vascular complications that are related to pregnancy. How did you come up with the idea for this particular exhibit and for the paper?
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. That's nice to hear. And the credit really for the idea is not mine to take. This was actually the brainchild of our senior author, Cookie Menyes, and she had has had a long interest in GYN imaging, and which I think crossed paths then with the interests in cardiothoracic and cardiovascular pregnancy complications among some of her former chess colleagues at Washington University, Silan Javid and Costa Raptis, who's here with us, and Sanjeev Bala. And, you know, after pooling, I think, some similar cases, the idea for, you know, the collaborative effort in imaging vascular complications really ensued. And, you know, it was really neat to see all the pieces come together.
Well, great. Well, thanks for that. After the introduction of your paper, in which you review some of the demographic issues that relate to smoking and diabetes and their effect on pregnancy, which obviously impact many of the conditions that you illustrated in the paper, you discuss the physiologic changes of pregnancy and you briefly review the selection of imaging examinations in pregnant patients. Can you touch on the use of magnetic resonance imaging in the pregnant patient?
Yeah, happy to. The role of MR imaging in pregnancy has really evolved now to much higher numbers, where I think it's becoming commonplace. Even, and for example, in the evaluation of appendicitis, so where ultrasound is sometimes difficult to localize the normal appendix in pregnant patients, MRI does so quite seamlessly. And the ACR now endorses MR imaging in pregnancy in all three trimesters, even on 3T. And in fact, Coast, I don't know if you want to comment on this, but I think that's probably been your experience as well at Mallinckrodt.
Yeah, I mean, in adult patients, MR definitely is our first line imaging test for appendicitis. Basically, as soon as we've confirm the patient is pregnant and they've had an ultrasound to ensure that they have an intrauterine pregnancy, we're not dealing with an ectopic. The next step, if there's concern for right lower quadrant pain and appendicitis, is an MR.
Great. Well, Costa, let's move to you. Your paper, after the introduction, moves on to discuss some of the vascular issues that relate to the prenatal period, where you detail several of the very well-recognized entities like preeclampsia, HELLP syndrome, and Budd-Chiari syndrome. But I'm not sure many radiologists are familiar with spontaneous coronary artery dissection as one of these vascular entities that are seen in pregnant patients. Can we look at a case of this, which is figure 4 in the paper? I should point out that you clearly state in the paper that emergency coronary arteriography and intravascular ultrasound are the procedures that are used in suspected cases, but that coronary CTA can be employed in patients in whom the suspicion is relatively low.
Yeah, that's actually absolutely correct. And, you know, we deal with so this is a pretty rare complication, a rare thing to happen in any patient, but it does have a slightly increased incidence with some spontaneous case reports in pregnant patients. And, you know, when you're dealing with a coronary artery dissection, whether you've got a patient who's pregnant or not pregnant, if that is really a strong clinical suspicion, our first line recommendation would be to do either an intravascular ultrasound or a cath. And the reason for that is because that's and oftentimes would help you, you'd be there with the cath, and then you could also treat the patient. You were going to consider stenting at the same time. There's really not a huge radiation savings between a cath and doing a coronary CTA. So, you know, you're not really saving the patient anything in that regard. What you are saving the patient if you do elect to do a CTA is you're avoiding having to do a catheterization and do a groin stick, so an arterial access. So you've got a patient where the concern is high, we would recommend going straight to a cath and evaluating in that means, and we do have that discussion with our cardiologists on occasion. Now, if you've got a patient who the suspicion is low, but it's still a consideration, and you just like to, you know, quote unquote, rule something like that out, given that it's so rare. I think a gated CTA is a decent test. Now, there's not a lot of literature to back up using it in order to know false negatives and false positives, that kind of stuff for a gated CTA. But really what you're looking for is the same thing you'd be looking for in a dissection in any vessel. Intimomedial flap, that would appear as a hypoattenuating line that goes through the vessel. Now, when you're dealing with the coronaries, they're not that large of vessels, so identifying the intimomedial flap can be difficult. In some patients, you may not actually see the flap. You may just see the vessel abruptly occlude, and we can assume that there may be a coronary artery dissection there. The real kicker when you're dealing with small vessels like the coronaries in the setting of coronary artery dissection is distinguishing an intimomedial flap from a flow artifact. Occasionally, you can get slow flow within the vessels, and that can produce these linear hypoattenuating defects within the lumen of the vessel that can simulate dissection flaps. So how do we distinguish those two things? Well, really the key features are that an intimomedial flap really should be a fairly sharp and well-defined linear hypoattenuating structure, whereas flow artifacts are often indistinct and look a little bit more like, quote, smoke. So if you see these flow artifacts in one plane, oftentimes they can simulate the intimomedial flap, but when you reconstruct them, I think it's often easier to identify their indistinct borders. So when we're dealing with a coronary CTA, question of a coronary artery dissection, it's very, very important that you do multiplanar reconstructions and really lay out that vessel to make sure that what you're looking at really does have those sharp margins, extends towards both walls of the vessel, and is not just an indistinct flow artifact. You can see in figure 4 here in the paper, and I know that it's a relatively subtle finding, but there is a linear hypoattenuating defect that kind of extends diagonally through the left coronary artery there, and you can see that that is the intimomedial flap in the setting of dissection in this patient. So we can make the diagnosis here on the imaging study, and then the question is, how do you treat this patient? Well, we've got a couple options. They could do attempt to stent the patient. Occasionally, they do bypasses in rare situations in which the coronary artery is severely thrombosed. The patient may even require a heart transplant.
Great. Well, thank you for that. Custer, rounding out this paper, reviews of Budd-Chiari syndrome and placental abruption. Now, in placental abruption, you indicate in the paper that ultrasound is somewhat limited in evaluation of placental abruption, and that MR may have a role in specific situations. Can you talk to us about the use of ultrasound in placental abruption and show us figure 9, which I think is a nice example of the use of MR in this particular setting?
Yeah, I mean, the issue with ultrasound in abruption is that it has a very high false negative rate. It's a difficult diagnosis to make. You're basically looking for a retroplacental hematoma, which is this intermediate echogenicity mass that occurs behind the placenta. It's tough to identify, very operator dependent. So it's an exam that's done frequently because it's available and it's not that hard to do it. But it is recognized to have a high false negative rate. Now, really, the diagnosis of placental abruption is a clinical one. So typically, you know, if you're going to make that diagnosis, it's done on clinical grounds, and ultrasound can be supportive. Now, if you've got a patient who has a negative ultrasound, and there's still a high suspicion for abruption, and it perhaps for a specific reason that knowing whether or not the patient has abruption could have an impact on their care, or how they would manage the patient, you could consider doing an MRI examination and just specifically for abruption. And just like with ultrasound, essentially what you're looking for is a blood clot or hematoma in the retroplacental area. And that can be marginal abruption, be right in the center of the placenta. There's different types of abruptions. But as you can see in figure 9 here, we have a T1 weighted non-contrast image. And you can see that there are these hyper intense blood products that are kind of within the amniotic sac, and that's blood in the amniotic sac, so concerning, and goes along with the history of vaginal bleeding. And then in number B here, or figure B, you can see that you've got a star that's positioned on a myometrial contracture, and that's really the big fooler in the setting of an abruption. You've got that the blood is there, the myometrial can contract, and that can itself look like a hematoma. But really, the finding here is the arrow that's placed on the hypo intense subchorionic retroplacental hematoma. So what you're looking for is that hematoma along the placenta, retroplacental, on the margin of the placenta, and it can have different appearances. It can be T1 hyperintense early, if it's an acute finding. If it's a more chronic abruption, it can be then evolved to more hypointense. So in this case, it's a hypointense on the T2 weighted images. So MR can help confirm the presence of that hematoma. Do I think it's a great test that we should be doing a ton of for abruption? I actually don't. But I think in specific situations where you've got a negative sonogram and there's still a pretty high clinical suspicion with some clinical import, I think it's a reasonable choice.
Great. Well, thank you for that. Dr. Plowman, let's move on to discuss some vascular entities that are encountered during delivery and in the postnatal period. You cover amniotic fluid embolism, venous sinus thrombosis, and some other conditions, and of course, acute pulmonary embolism. Table 3 shows the imaging algorithm that is currently endorsed by the thoracic radiology community, the pulmonary medicine organizations, and the obstetrical societies, which I think is really important to review, but as you probably know, unfortunately, is not always followed clinically. So can we just take a look at Table 3 here, and perhaps you could just talk through some of the recommendations as far as imaging of patients with suspected pulmonary embolism in pregnancy?
Yeah, of course, absolutely. Indeed, the Society of Thoracic Radiology and, as you mentioned, the American Thoracic Society, as well as the ACOG, I'll recommend initial compressive lower extremity ultrasound for pregnant patients with positive leg syndrome symptoms of DVT. And then, you know, chest radiography is recommended for those without leg symptoms. And then, you know, following that, ventilation perfusion scintigraphy and CT pulmonary angiography would, you know, generally follow an either a negative or positive chest radiography result sort of respectively. So, you know, going through kind of the table a little bit more specifically, then we see that in item number 3 there of the table, it specifically says if no signs and symptoms of DVT exist, pulmonary vascular imaging instead of lower extremity compressive ultrasound is suggested. And then skipping to number 5, it says if chest radiography findings are normal, then lung scintigraphy, or as we know, VQ scan is suggested. And the next imaging should be the next imaging test rather than a CT pulmonary angiography. And finally, I think what's interesting is for scintigraphy, PIOPED 2 study criteria reserves high probability diagnoses, which is above greater than 80% likelihood of pulmonary embolism for those patients who have two or more large segmental unmatched perfusion defects without correlative findings at chest radiography, hence the negative indication following a chest radiography. So CTPA is, of course, highly specific and allows for visualization of the embolus within the pulmonary arterial circulation. But for patients then who have those positive findings, even initially at compressive ultrasound, anticoagulation therapy is recommended.
Yeah, I would just add one thing about this table. And it's important, I think, as a radiologist, I'm a cardiothoracic radiologist, we deal with this situation. It's not common, obviously, but it does happen probably several times a month. And the rationale for this is really based on limiting the breast dose to the mother. You know, if you really came down to fetal dose, VQ as a higher fetal dose than a CT for pulmonary embolism. CT for pulmonary embolism is really only like less than a milligray dose to the fetus, so it's extremely low dose. And what we're trying to do in this protocol is limit the breast dose to the mother, and the breasts are more radiosensitive during pregnancy, and there's a much higher breast dose with a CT pulmonary embolism protocol than there is a VQ scan. So we'd like to get the VQ scan and get an answer and do just one test. So that's why we use that chest radiograph. And if the chest radiograph is normal, you've got a pretty good chance that you might get like a normal or very abnormal VQ. The problem is if you've got an abnormal chest x-ray, that greatly increases your chance of an indeterminate or not clinically useful report on your VQ. So then we just go to P protocol just so that we do only one study. But the rationale for this table, I think it's important to understand that so you can convey that to your clinical colleagues, is to limit the breast dose. And I think if you have an agreed upon plan with your obstetric and ED colleagues that is based around a table like this, I think it's very easy to employ it in real clinical practice as long as everybody's on board ahead of time. I think it's harder in real time to direct these things without agreements, you know, up to us.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think, you know, again, as another cardiothoracic radiologist, one of our biggest struggles is the imaging, not so much of pregnant young women, but of young women who present with chest pain or symptoms in whom you're trying to convince the, you know, your clinical colleagues that ventilation perfusion scan is a very sensitive way to exclude PE. And that the issue with the CT study, as you say, is really more of a matter of breast radiation than it is to be concerning to the fetus in the pregnant patient. So I think that's probably an ongoing struggle for which, at least at present, there seems to be no real solution. But thank you for that explanation. Dr. Raptis, the final portion of the paper discusses a couple of the underlying conditions that can be exacerbated by pregnancy. Can we look at one of these cases, which is figure 20, which I think is a nice example of a patient with underlying aortopathy that you illustrate here, where pregnancy is likely associated with or exacerbates the presence of acute aortic pathology?
Right. So, you know, there's a bunch of different aortic or vascular conditions that result in an increased risk over your lifetime of aneurysms and dissections. Those include more common things like Marfan's. Lois Dietz is a rare one. There are other heritable aortopathies. And during pregnancy, these patients have an increased risk of complications. So in many situations, in patients, particularly with Lois Dietz, we have a large population of Lois Dietz at our institution. In patients who have known aneurysms, we actually get them screening MR during their pregnancy just to make sure we sort of have a baseline of where their aneurysm's at. I can evaluate if any are changing rapidly. Now, these patients can also present acutely with complications related to these symptoms. One of the big ones is aortic dissection. We show that in figures 20 and 21. These are two different patients. You can see in figure 20, there's an aortic dissection involving that descending aorta. That patient went on for an emergent ascending aortic repair. It was a type A dissection. Went on for an emergent type A ascending aortic repair. In figure 21A, it was another patient who already had had a stented descending aorta who developed a proximal extension of their aortic dissection or a superimposed aortic dissection involving their ascending aorta. You can see that as a large outpouching false lumen in number 21A, the white arrows pointing to that. So, you know, really the issue with pregnant patients is twofold. One is, recognizing that if a patient has an underlying risk factor or genetic syndrome that places them at risk for acute aortic syndromes in this fashion, imaging is definitely indicated in the acute setting. You might also want to consider using it in the more chronic setting when the patient, before the patient has symptoms, just to get a baseline for where they're at. And in those situations, we usually use a non-con MR just to get a lay of the land for where they're at. So, you know, these are serious issues and obviously can lead to very bad outcomes. So imaging promptly is necessary.
Great. Well, thank you for that. Really nice examples of that condition. So I'd like to thank Dr. Scooter Plowman, Dr. Costa Raptis for taking the time today to discuss their paper, which deals with pregnancy-related vascular complications, which can be found in the current July 2017 issue of Radiographics. Doctors, thank you very much for your discussion today.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thank you. It's a pleasure.